Welcome everyone to the University of Hong Kong Library. My name is Gary Chin. I am the Public Relations and Development Manager for the libraries. And I'd like to welcome you to the brand new seminar room. This room was just released, well, it's actually in its soft opening. Curtains arrived just a few days ago. And we wanted to use this room to break it into our new book talk. We have larger audiences. We're going to have to see about where we're going to have you standing. But eventually, we want to keep this more intimate and more informal conversations. So without any further ado, I'd like you to welcome you to the Polio, the Odyssey of Eradication book talk. Tonight's speakers are Thomas Abraham, Honorary Associate Professor, Journalism and Media Studies Center, Hong Kong U, Professor Keiji Fukuda, Director of School of Public Health, Hong Kong U, and Keith Richburg, Director, Journalism and Media Studies Center, Hong Kong U. Keith will be your moderator this evening, and I will now pass it over to Keith.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks for the library, the HKU Main Library, for having us. I guess we're the inaugural event in this brand new space. So, yeah, thank you very much. So we're breaking it in. We're getting started now, even though we know a few people always trickle in late in the back. That's HKU. People have a hard time walking across the campus. First of all, I want to say this is actually the second of our JMSC, we're the Journalism and Media Studies Center. This is the second of our JMSC writer-in-residence book talks. The first one was Cheng Chong, who's hiding in the back, which was a month ago. And then if you're around, we're going to have another one here. It's going to be in this space, I think, next month, November 8th, by Tom Wright, Wall Street Journal Pulitzer Prize finalist, who wrote a book on the Malaysian 1MBD scandal called Billion Dollar Whale. That's doing very well. So please come for that if you're around. But we're going to be talking today about polio and infectious diseases. And my job as moderator really is to introduce the two experts over here and then pretty much get out of the way and have a conversation between them. So Keiji, we'll get to you later on. But I think first we're going to hear from someone we all know very well here at the university, Thomas Abraham, who, when I arrived here 2 years ago as director, he said, "I'm working on this book about polio." Wow, polio, we'd write a whole book about polio. And then I just read the first chapter of it and I was gripped. So I didn't have a chance to read the whole thing. I was almost late coming over here because it was so interesting in the beginning. So without further ado, I'll introduce Thomas, who's gonna speak for a little while, kind of give us some summary of the book, and then we'll have a conversation between these two experts over here. Thomas.
Thank you very much, Keith, and thank you very much to, I feel really honored to inaugurate this lovely space. I think we're all honored to do that. And. Thank you for that endorsement. Just imagine you almost missed the event because the book was so gripping. Honey to an author's ears. So let me tell you a little bit about myself. I'm not a medical person. I'm not a public health expert. I'm not a scientist. I'm not a biologist, a virologist, or any kind of other kind of scientist. I'm a journalist. And I was teaching at Hong Kong U, and before that I spent about 25, 30 years in journalism. And so the obvious question, I'd like to take you through this journey, the journey that led to the creation of a book. How does a journalist write a book about public health, or science, or medicine for that matter? And I did it in the way I used the method of journalism, that is, find an interesting question, ask, do research, ask people, go and see things, and in a sense, be a little bit like, and have you seen the way a dog or a cat will worry its, you know, it'll worry its favorite toy, shake it about a bit, see what happens. And finally, when you've got all the facts, try and assemble that into a logical, coherent narrative, which hopefully will give people some idea of what the problem is and what the issues are. So that's exactly what I did. How did this book start? Well, about a decade ago, I worked for a year at the World Health Organization. I was on sabbatical from Hong Kong U at Geneva, and that was the first time I met Keiji Fukuda here. We worked together briefly. And that was when I got interested, I first heard about this ambitious program to eradicate polio. And I was struck by the ambition behind this, because eradication is probably one of the most complex, technically complex ways to protect ourselves from disease. Eradication means ending a disease forever. So not us, not our children, not our grandchildren, not their children, basically the human race until the end of time does not have to bother about this disease forever. And how do you do that? You do that by removing from nature, by driving to extinction, the microbe, the bug, the pathogen that causes disease. In the case of polio, it's a virus, an RNA virus, and even in the scale, viral scale, it's a tiny virus. Probably, I don't know, the order of several million times smaller than, you know, a grain of salt that you would shake out of a salt shaker. Now the human race, we have driven many things to extinction, but usually they're things that we can see, right? Dodos, mastodons, I don't know what else. Large animals which we've hunted, we've killed, we've driven to extinction. How do you drive a virus to extinction? And mind you, viruses have existed on Earth long before we have, the human race appeared, and they'll probably be there long after we leave as well. They're resilient. And this really struck me. I mean, this is the equivalent of landing a man on the moon. I think this is harder than landing a man on the moon, but it displays the same ambition, the same audacity. And that was the first thing that really gripped me, this whole idea. Now, the program to eradicate polio was launched in 1988 by the member countries of the World Health Organization, which is pretty much the entire world. Every country in the world almost is there may be a few exceptions, is a member of the World Health Organization. 1988, they got together and they passed a resolution saying that we will eradicate polio. Not we will do our best, or we will attempt. We want to eradicate polio by the year 2000. And this will be our gift, the gift from the 20th century to the 21st century. And this is actually the wording of the resolution. And once more I said, wow, this is interesting. Now here's where the journalism kicks in. We are now in the year 2018. 18 years beyond schedule. Each year costs $1 billion. So the first journalist, this is where a journalist's instinct kicks in. Wow, this is tremendous, but something's going on. What is going on? If you ask the polio program, they will answer quite rightly that, you know, since 1988, polio has disappeared from 99% of the world. In 1988, there were at least 350,000 recorded cases, and probably double or triple that number of cases which were unrecorded. It was a big disease. It was spread on every country across the world. There were very few countries that were polio free. Today, if you look at the map of the world, there's only Pakistan, Afghanistan, Nigeria, which is a slight question mark over it, where polio has never been stopped. And so the answer was that we have succeeded, 99% of the world, you know, it's done, it's just a little bit more. But then I encountered another problem. This has been the same case for the last 5 to 6 years, exactly 99%, those three countries. The last big achievement of the polio program was eradicating polio from India in the year 2011. Since then, nothing much seemed to be happening. And there were other worrying things happening. There were new cases of countries where polio had been eradicated. They were coming back, and this time it was coming back from the vaccine itself. Now the vaccine, I'll talk about a little bit more, it's one of the most wonderful vaccines ever invented, but it's not like all medical interventions, or it is not perfect, and this is one of the problems that you have. So why is this coming back? There were other things that intrigued me, puzzled me. There were stories of parents refusing vaccination for their children. Now, parents are the same everywhere. We all have that same instinct that has been sort of, it's a genetic instinct. That's why the human race is 250,000 years old at least, right? To do the best for the next generation and to ensure that the next generation, you know, continues. So why were parents refusing vaccine for a disease that could cripple children? And this was not the same as the anti-vaccine movement that you see in the West. This was something different. Because the same mothers who did not, in Pakistan, for example, I saw mothers who did not want to vaccinate, who were closing their doors when polio vaccinators knocked on the door. These same women would take their children and queue up in front of medical practitioners to get all the other childhood vaccinations. So it was not that they were against vaccines. It was not that they didn't understand that vaccines are good for you. So what was going on there? And once more, from the polio program, nobody really understood this. And the answer was that, oh, these are not very well-educated people. But that is no answer at all, because all of us have got exactly the same brains, the same capacity for intelligence, the same capacity for rational thought. It's once more something that's wired into us. So we don't need degrees. We don't even need to be literate to understand, you know, a logical argument. So what was going on there? And there were two other questions as well. Why were polio vaccinators getting shot? Over 100 people vaccinated, many of them women, who were going out to vaccinate for polio drops, they were getting shot and targeted. What was happening? What was going on there? This also raised an ethical question, which I'll come back to later. And this really puzzled me. Is it worth an adult losing her life in order to protect a child from a crippling disease? I don't know what the answer is, but this is an answer I think that needs to be. So at least 100 people have lost their lives in order to prevent paralysis in other children. Where do we draw a balance? Is there a balance to be drawn? I don't know the answers to these questions, but this was an intriguing question for me. A lot of these questions, especially the first question, came to a head, and it was really summarized for me when I was in northern Nigeria, in Kano province, in the middle of 2012. And this was an area where large numbers of people had been refusing polio vaccination for their children. And so I traveled along with teams of communicators and vaccinators from UNICEF and the WHO. UNICEF is the UN Children's Organization, and they partner up with WHO along with the USCDC, the Gates Foundation, and Rotary International in running. So we went to this village, and we knocked on these old mud huts with these lovely thatched roofs, idyllic. At least for an outsider, it's idyllic. I don't know what the people living there think. They probably wouldn't be that happy. Well, we walked in to the house of a man who had refused to vaccinate his children. And this is a guy called Sabu. He was a farmer. And so we all sat on the floor in this hut. And the UNICEF team sort of, with translators, including the village headman's wife, trying to persuade him, do this, it's good for your child, and so on. So Sabu finally gave up. I mean, all these foreigners are coming, and I guess the inherent courtesy that people have when visitors come to you, and said, okay, I'll do it. Everybody walked out, I stayed with him, and then suddenly he exploded. He said, polio, polio, polio. Why polio? And then he explained, if his child was ill, he needed to walk to the main road, wait for some form of transportation, take a bus to the nearest primary healthcare center, which is between five and 10 kilometers away, wait in line there, see if there were medicines. If there weren't medicines, he needed to go somewhere else, pay money, go to a private practitioner, maybe just come back with the child at the end of the day. Measles and malaria were the biggest, if not killers, the biggest cause of morbidity of illness among children. You had diarrhea, you had rivers of sludge and sewage running outside people's homes. And it caused me to think, in this context, polio clearly was not a priority. It was a global priority because you have this global campaign. But once you get down to the grassroots level, there's something else going on. And this is not irrationality, it's not stupidity, it's not lack of literacy. It's basically making sense of the world that you find around you, right? This does not make sense to you. Why polio? And actually, that was the question, really, that has sort of, that the narrative thread, if you will, that run polio, 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 why polio? And this, in a sense, is an attempt to answer Savio's questions, right? And one fundamental reason was that global health programs, they're ambitious, they're audacious, they do wonderful things, and they tackle some of the greatest health issues that we have today. Maternal child mortality, tuberculosis, malaria, all of these things, various tropical diseases, which are known as neglected tropical diseases, and so on and so forth. But they don't always meet the needs of the people at the other end. So these are planned, they are conceived from international organizations, fundraisers, really carefully thought out. But once they get out into the ground, we face a different reality. And I think one of the issues, one of the lessons of things that I came away with is there's this huge, for want of a better word, a democratic deficit in global health. And it's not just in health, I'm sure it's in a whole bunch of other things where at one end you have people making grand plans and funding them as well, at the other end you have the people around who nobody really listens to. There was also a second reason for vaccine refusal. Muslim communities in India, in Pakistan, everybody is Muslim, but migrant communities, they were the ones who were pushing back very, very heavily against vaccines, especially in India. And I'll give you the example of India. Polio was very hard to stamp out in India. There were two large populous states, Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, where you've got very heavy concentration of population, you've got poor sanitation, you've got poor health services. It's hard to get vaccines to everybody. Plus, you get pushback from certain communities. And this was particularly so in the case of the Muslim communities in these areas. And why was that? Because many of them felt that they were minorities, they felt marginalized, they felt they'd been discriminated by the state government and by, you know, everybody else for a long time. Once more, they got nothing free. And the only thing that the government was trying to push on them was family planning and contraception, because there was this myth that Muslims are breeding too much. And at that time, there was a very strong right-wing, conservative, Hindu-majoritarian government in India. The same guys are back in power now, but that's a different question. And so when the government comes and gives something to a community that has received nothing from the government except suspicion, it's met by suspicion again. So in a sense, it's nothing, very little to do with science or with epidemiology. It's much more about this is, you need to see these things in their social context. Why were vaccinators getting killed? And this is something else that happened to the polio virus, or something else that helped the polio virus to survive. The polio virus got caught or made use of the huge sort of fissures that appeared in the world post 9/11, between, and I'm simplifying hugely here, between the West and the Muslim world. And so rumors against vaccination started. It started initially in Nigeria, where you had mullahs who were saying that, you know, the West, do you think they care anything for your children? No. All of this is revenge for 9/11. This is the West's revenge for the 9/11 attacks. They're giving this to your children to make your daughters sterile. Right? They want to wipe our population out. And so this was amplified. It spread to India. It spread to Pakistan. So there was that going on as well. Then came the war between the Taliban and the West, the Taliban in the United States, Taliban in Afghanistan and in Pakistan as well. And one of the things, one of the weapons that was being used by the US government were drones in the frontier areas of Pakistan to try. And the one thing that the Pakistan Taliban wanted was to stop these drones. So they said, They figured out this vaccination thing is important to all you guys. It's important to the Pakistan government, whom we're trying to overthrow. It's important to the Americans, whom we're trying, whom we'd love to overthrow if we could get there. So we're going to hold this hostage. And so they said, stop the drone attacks, and then we will allow vaccination. That clearly did not happen. Then they started saying, these vaccinators are really spies. How come the drones always know where to target us? It is because these vaccinators are spies, they're giving information back. All of this is a grand conspiracy theory until something happened. And that something was the hunt for Osama bin Laden. One of the sideshows in the hunt for bin Laden, though bin Laden had been identified, I think the US government, the CIA, whoever was involved, was pretty much sure that this old Arab guy with a lot of wives and a whole bunch of children in this compound, in this town in Pakistan with very high walls, whom all the neighbors had never seen except to say that these are Arabs. These sort of narrow dancers probably bin Laden. But one of the things that they wanted was some sort of evidence, and they wanted genetic evidence, if possible, to really make it foolproof. So one of the things that happened was that the CIA either funded or set up an NGO to carry out a program of vaccination against hepatitis in this town. So they approached the doctor, said, you know, God, we'd really like to inoculate every child against hepatitis. And would you do it? And the doctor said, sure. And he also said that, you know, each time you inoculate a child just to make sure that you know that you're getting to everybody, just take a small swab from the child's cheek as well, right? And basically genetic material. So this vaccination program was launched. When they got to the bin Laden compound, nobody opened the door. So this didn't really work, right? But after the attack, the Pakistan government was so embarrassed by the fact that, first of all, bin Laden was sitting there in the midst of, in their midst for all these years. And number two, that American helicopters, special forces, had been able to cross the border from Afghanistan, carry out this raid, get out without anybody really knowing, except the neighbors who suddenly saw, all of this going on, but the Pakistan military knew nothing. So in this general embarrassment, there was a committee of inquiry, arrests were made, this doctor was arrested, he told his story, and that was it. Except the Taliban suddenly said, we told you so. When we said these vaccinators were all spies, you didn't listen to us, right? We told you so. So this all fed in, a whole bunch of things really fed in. And in a sense, the hunt for the poliovirus really is a mirror through which to understand the world that we live in and the times that we live in. And which is one more reason why a non-medical person or a non-expert finds disease a fascinating mirror or lens by which to understand the world. A mirror, really, to look at ourselves in the world. There's one last issue that I'm going to talk about before handing it over. And this is probably the most difficult thing to write about, in a sense. The oral polio vaccine is a wonderful vaccine. It was developed by Albert Sabin. It has almost a miraculous propensity to drive the natural or wild polio virus out of circulation. It contains within it a weakened form of the polio virus, like many live virus vaccines, which can provoke an immune reaction without provoking disease. So, and this is it, right? You get the vaccine, your immune system is all primed up, and when the real polio virus comes, you get an immunity. However, it also has a problem. For one in every 2.2 to 2.5 million doses distributed to children, that child, for reasons that are still unknown, because each one of us, I guess, are slightly different genetically, develops polio. And this is called vaccine-associated paralytic paralysis. Now, this risk is small. You see, 1 in 2.5 million. It's really, really tiny. But if you look at the numbers globally, and this is by the WHO's old figures, but not now, but say about 5 years ago, because now we've switched to an injectable, to the inactivated vaccine, 400 to 500 children every year were being paralyzed by the vaccine itself, and another 100 to 150 in India alone, right? Now this sounds shocking, but if you look at the context once more, when poliovirus is circulating everywhere, the protective effect of the vaccine is far greater, and you're, in a sense, you can turn this around and say you're protecting a million children from, you know, at the cost of one child who gets it. And it's unfortunate for the one child, it's actually terrible for the one child, but there is a rationale behind this. But what started happening, this 99% of the world is clear, as the numbers of the risk of getting polio from the wild poliovirus, the natural poliovirus, receded to almost zero, the only real risk now is from the vaccine itself. And so this is something I spent a lot of time talking to people in the polio program, because it made me really uncomfortable, and you get a lot of, and he said, you know, without this vaccine, polio would have been everywhere, and now we just need to continue with it until it ends. In the United States, where OPV oral polio vaccine has been withdrawn from, I think, the late 1990s, you had vaccine compensation programs for any child. And it's not just a child, it's close contacts of the child, including mothers, siblings, perhaps, who are paralyzed. No questions asked, vaccine compensation systems. Countries like India and the developing world, nobody even talks about this. There is no compensation, there is no recognition. Is this right? I don't know. And these are just questions that arise. You can see the good that is being done, but you can also see that there is collateral damage, if you will. So this left me uncomfortable, and this is something, but these are things that we need to discuss and understand, I think, because it's not bad people doing these things, right? But it's more to understand the risks and benefits of anything, any intervention that we make, any medical intervention for that matter. Okay, perhaps one last thing which made me uncomfortable. You know, I've been talking about you work 5 years on a book, and you can talk about it all day long. There's very little else in my brain at the moment. But one last point. And that last point really is, when I went to a vaccinating team, parents were being jailed or threatened with jail in Pakistan, in India, in Nigeria for not vaccinating their children. They were, vaccinators were knocking on doors with police escorts, basically to raise the pressure on children, get them vaccinated. Now these are things would have been completely unacceptable in the West, in any other part. I mean, they'd have been a public outcry. But here, because you're dealing with human beings really at the bottom of the global pecking order, these things are acceptable. Is that right? This, I think, I definitely not. But then what is the answer? Are you going to get informed consent from parents if you want to eradicate a disease in some of the poorest, least developed parts of the world? How would you go about that? Most people say no. What's going to happen? Once more, as a journalist, all I can do is raise questions. I have no answers. There are people who are far better equipped than I am to deal with answers, and one of whom is sitting on my left, so I think I will.
Well, thank you for that, Thomas. That was fantastic, and I am going to let somebody who knows far more than any of us talk about this. I can just say, though, your talk was fantastic. It was very compelling. I could tell everybody was hanging on to every word, so you can all see why he was such a great teacher and a beloved teacher at the JMSC. What I took away when I read the first chapter and then kind of skimmed through the book was, you know, one thing was just how in the world of these global diseases, there's this tension, I guess you could call it, between eradication versus control. Should we try to eradicate it, or should we just give people medicine to control it? I thought that was very interesting. I'm bringing this right over to you, Keiji. These decisions are made not in the countries themselves. It seems that they're made in Geneva or New York or elsewhere, and the people on the ground in some countries may have a different priority system. So Thomas gave us this great, you know, introduction to polio now. And I looked at your bio earlier, Keiji, and you were an expert on all the bad things out there, Ebola, SARS, MERS, and you worked at the Centers for Disease Control, so you've got a lot of experience. How do you put what Thomas said into kind of a broader context?
So thanks, Keith. I'm not sure I'm any less confused about any of these issues than Thomas, but let me also step back for a second. If you haven't seen Thomas's book, it's a fantastic read. It's compelling. It does draw you in from the beginning. but it also is, it raises issues which ring true. These are, you know, I have been working in global public health for a long time. And every issue that Thomas raised in there, I think, are issues which either from firsthand experience I have seen or gone through or been part of discussions. And so I think that if you want to understand a lot of the dilemmas about public health, and in this sense, it's really public health writ large. I mean, these are really social issues in a lot of ways. I mean, same issues being debated for polio. Really, you can see that they resonate for issues which are being debated in other areas of society. So it is a fantastic book. He's not paying you for plugging the book, but I will put that in. The second thing, also to give you a little bit of an idea about why I think about things in the way that I do. Again, you know, my basic training was as a physician, taking care of individual patients. And then later it was to go to CDC and to begin to work on public health and to begin to see things in a different way. And I then went on to WHO where I met Thomas. We met really at the beginning of pandemic of influenza in 2009. But that also, for me, was a kind of new world in that it really brought into my daily life sort of diplomatic negotiation types of issues, which really Thomas is alluding to in this thing. So with that as kind of a background, I actually wasn't quite sure how Thomas was going to present the book and so on, and so I've been jotting down notes, and let me just sort of give you a couple of thoughts that come through, and then we're really hoping to hear a lot of questions from the audience. Well, I think in the first place, as Keith mentioned, the whole idea of eradication itself is a debatable idea. I mean, there have been strong proponents of it, and there have been strong opponents for it. And I think for one of the reasons which Keith raised, which is you can take a lot of effort and resources and put it into getting rid of something, eradication, and it is a very sort of satisfying idea. The idea that you forever get rid of something for generations is a very compelling idea. It fueled smallpox, and to be free of smallpox is something which is a great thing. It is genuinely good for future generations. On the other hand, as Keith mentioned, you know, resources are limited. Resources are not just money. They're really patience, they're politics, they're all of those things. You can use them in a different way, and so there are very strong proponents saying that eradicating or focusing on single diseases is a waste. Really, you should focus on the systems. You should have a much more horizontal approach so you can deal with things. And so, putting that aside, but the other change, you know, which is really brought about by technology now, is that because of synthetic biology and the ability to now create viruses or create molecules which could not be created even a short while ago, the whole question of what does eradication mean is now a debatable issue. So this is something which has changed a lot in our lifetime, and so it's another thing on there. But in looking at, in reading Thomas's book, the first thing that really struck me was, you know, why do we do things? Why do we do things which are big and messy and just lead us into a lot of headaches in a lot of ways? And so, you know, so what are big things? Well, big things are war, they're peace, societal programs. These are big things. You know, we can plan to do small things. We can plan classes. We can plan how we're going to teach. We can plan our daily life. But big things in reality are unplannable. Because big things take a lot of people. They may take all countries. They take a lot of time. And when you put those things down, what it means is that you can get big things started, but nobody in reality can see the end of them. And so really, polio eradication, like smallpox eradication, like all these big things, were started by people who really fundamentally believed that achieving something would be worth all of the pain and all of the trouble to get them done. But if anyone says that we really thought it through, they're not telling you the truth. You know, all of these things require political will, they require time, they require money, and they surely require a lot of luck. And so whether polio will get eradicated or not is not clear. As Thomas points out in his book, depending on who you speak to, the message is unrelentingly upbeat. We're almost there. We're going to do it. And in fact, we're very close to it. But, you know, are we going to get there? You know, it's still an open question. So I think that that's one of the things I wanted to put down, that I don't think it's quite easy or fair to say whether we succeed or we fail on these big initiatives and so on. It's almost too simplistic a way for me to judge these things, because in part, the journey itself brings about a lot of positive benefits. You know, if we look at the polio campaign, and the polio people who are proponents of it will point out, this has led to the training of millions of people. It has sort of gotten a lot of health messages out there. And the spin-off benefits, not the original goals, but the spin-off benefits, have meant a lot. And in fact, if you look at a place like Africa right now, a lot of the people who are doing things unrelated to polio are funded by polio money. And what to do when that money runs out has been one of the most, it's one of the issues that WHO, that I would sit in on that discussion sometime, because that money will not be there forever, and the program will end one way or the other. But the second issue I thought about was, if we start things and we don't really have a clear plan for it, how do we know when to end? I mean, what do you do with these things once they go on? And again, I think if we turn our attention to the issue at hand, polio, as Thomas pointed out, you know, the original projections for eradicating polio are almost two decades old now. So the first time, the first benchmark was the year 2000, and then it keeps going backwards and backwards. And so we're now at 2018. We know polio is in two countries. It's just a handful of cases in two countries. We're a little bit worried about Nigeria, whether it's really there or not, because there are a lot of kids which can't be reached. And so, if we're having so much trouble, why do we keep going on? And again, I think that the issue is partly, when you're so close to something, it is hard to give up. It's simply a human thing, like, we're just a few meters away. Can't we just gut it out and get there? That's a very deeply human thing. But the second thing is that there has been a lot of money invested in this. As Thomas said, you know, approximately $15 billion have been put into it. So if you step away so close to the end, does that mean that you've sort of wasted all that money? Is the message that we almost got there and decided to give up because something was not quite good enough? And this really occupies decision makers a lot. You know, am I walking away from my legacy? Am I walking away and saying the strategy for all of these years was really a waste? And that's something which is really hard for people to accept. But I think the third thing is that in terms of the global eradication program, there is a genuine worry about a knock-on effect. If you have a big failure, does that big failure then mean that it permeates public health and it really sends this image that this is an area which can't get things done? And so there's both reasons about the past and there's reasons about the future which somehow keep these things going on. But again, how it's going to end, I don't know. But one of the issues I did want to also highlight is that we often talk about things being expensive, and in a certain sense, $15 billion is a lot of money. But you know, in thinking about this, I went to Google today and I looked up how much did it cost to run the World Cup in soccer. So the cumulative cost of those teams that were fielded for that is something like $12 billion. So that's for, you know, really a series of football games. I also looked up the cost of a modern aircraft carrier. So it's about $13 billion. And what often happens, and it's a little bit frustrating when you're in health, is the sense that health is a zero-sum game in terms of money. If we don't put it into polio, could that money have been put somewhere else? When in fact, the real thing ought to be that we have a lot of needs and that those needs are valuable. Somehow it should not be thought of as a zero-sum game. Thomas also said, he raised a phrase which really struck me, democratic deficit. This is a tough issue because in a place like WHO, it can feel very top-down. In Geneva, you sit with ministers of health, you sometimes sit with presidents of countries, you sit with ministries of economics and so on. And, you know, so much of the world looks to Geneva or to New York and says, well, you know, what direction should we go in? Well, in theory, what is talked about in Geneva should reflect what is important in countries and communities. That should go to governments, and it's the governments coming together. So in theory, there is a nice mechanism for this to work out. But in fact, as Thomas pointed out in his book, you know, there's a pretty big difference between the reality and the theory in a number of different instances. But it's still a little bit more complicated than that, I think. There are issues which are really raised bottom up. And for me, the outstanding issue has been HIV. Now, HIV is an issue which was really driven by the social level. It was really people who are affected by HIV. It's really that whole community which really set the paradigm that we do not accept that we don't control the directions of how we are treated. We do not accept that you only have expensive drugs and they will not be made cheaper and so on. So I think things can be driven bottom up at times. It's also true, I think, that there are issues which are driven top down, but it's also not necessarily a bad thing. You know, some of, if I were to look at the issues which I think are the most important public health issues today, again, climate change and pollution would be in the top two or three issues that I would have up there. These are very hard for communities to deal with. This is really something which does require a kind of top down. So the reality right now is we have a gemisch, we have this mix of ways in which decisions are made, how things are started. I think the question of whether it can be done better, I don't know, because it involves people, it involves communities. So this is my last point. You know, among the events I've worked on in the past, you know, one of the things I was most directly involved with was has been influenza. My career in many ways has dealt with various forms of this. And when bird flu first came out, you know, came out in Hong Kong in 1997, and then around 2003, it kind of exploded in Asia. And during that time, there were a number of investigations which were done, Vietnam, Thailand, Indonesia, and so on. And some of the exact points which Thomas raised related to polio were raised during those investigations. In Sumatra, for example, there were people who said, why are you strange people coming here and bothering us about something that doesn't bother us and so on? Who are you? And, you know, what are you doing here? And it was a lot of distrust, and it was really very palpable. Same thing happened during Ebola when I was in West Africa and so on. And again, there can be a huge amount of distrust and disbelief on the level of communities for these events which are being held. Having said that, if you put yourself back in this seat of being in Geneva and you see something like bird flu beginning to develop globally, you know, it is alarming. There is genuine alarm about what to do. And so these, you know, as Thomas said, the bottom line is that there are no nice and clean answers to these things. They are tough issues. From my perspective, you have to talk them through every single time. As we go forward in time, the context changes, the questions may still be there, but the answer to that question can change over time depending on how the context changes. I'm not sure we're going to be that much better off. But anyways, it is a fantastic book. I really urge you to read it.
Thank you, Rick.
I'll use the one that's already on. Thank you very much. Yeah, really interesting intervention there, Keiji. Before we get to questions, and I hope you have a lot, because I'm going to pass the mic around in just a minute, but I'll take the moderator's role just to point out, number one, you just kind of tacking on what you said, there was a really compelling scene in that first chapter of the book where I read, where you've got this whole army of vaccinators going through this little village in Pakistan, surrounded by soldiers protecting them, and at one point, they pass a house, and an old man looks out and said, "Hey, my wife is sick. Can you help?" They said, "No, we're not here for that." And they kept moving on because they had their job was polio. Here's this poor guy, and he just wants something for his wife. So his need was very immediate, but they said they had bigger fish to fry. And I guess a question really for both of you: you know, I know, KG, you mentioned that they didn't want to give up because, number one, they were so close. Number two, they'd spent all that money so far. And then number three, there might be some knockoff effects with other public health emergencies if they gave up without eradicating. How much also is it that polio was eradicated in America and eradicated in Europe, and they were worried that if they didn't eradicate it in these existing pockets, that it might come back because people can get on planes and they can get it. So it could come back to the West. How much was that a factor?
Oh, I think it's a real factor. I mean, public health is funny. I mean, it genuinely reflects, I think, the best instincts of people, which is that independent of any of those considerations, something is not good. Let's change. Dirty water is not good. Let's make it cleaner. Bad hygiene is not good. Let's improve that. But I think it is also very clear that there are power politics which are involved. And I think that when you come to infectious diseases, the fear of richer countries in terms of being harmed in their perspective by poorer countries is a real factor. You know, when you looked at Ebola, there was an embargo of airplanes. Airplanes stopped flying there, and, you know, these are planes which are going to Europe, which are going to North America, and so on. And in every issue that I have dealt with, there is always that kind of, you know, geopolitical element, which is a real element.
I'll back that up. One of the people I met in the context of the book, sadly no more now, was a legendary Brazilian epidemiologist and public health figure known as Ciro de Quadros, who cut his teeth in the smallpox eradication campaign and later championed. He was based in the WHO regional office for the Americas. And he championed the whole idea of eliminating polio from the Americas. And then when I met him, I think about 4 years ago, I said, you know, why did you need to take it one step further? He said, you know what, we had struggled and driven polio out of even the last little village high up in the Andes, you know, out from the Brazilian rainforest. And the only way we could protect these gains is to make sure that the polio virus did not come back. It had to be globally eliminated. Otherwise, all the effort that we had put in, so he said it was a no-brainer. We had to do it at a global level.
You know, I think that one, to expand on this point a little bit, I think that, but I don't see it really only as a rich country, poor country issue. If you look at SARS and you look at communities within mainland China, there were villages which prevented people from coming in. And you can see that at a level where you remove the kind of geopolitical economics and so on, that fear of being contaminated is a very deep visceral fear. So it's simply by using the word contagion or unknown infectious diseases, you can immediately begin to change the behavior of people. And I think it goes way beyond just, I mean, there is a real, we are rich and we don't want to be harmed element, but I think it goes deeper than that also.
Okay, why don't you two keep the microphone? Because I've got a loud voice, I'm told by my assistant. Somewhere there's a microphone out here in the audience, and I would be remiss if I did not call on my own student, who's a journalism student, for the very first question. Because being a good journalism student, he had his hand up even while they were still talking. So.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Brian McGovern. I'm a journalist for Pendrell Times of JMSC. I'm really interested in the topic of CRISPR. I'm sure you know about this, Cas9. And which is being used in good ways right now, for example, to modify the germlines of mosquitoes to eradicate malaria in Africa, just broke out. But I'm also worried about how it could be used in negative ways. For example, maybe it could be used to reignite polio or other diseases. So I'm wondering, with the advent of new technologies like CRISPR to modify DNA, how does that influence what you're working on, both of you? Thank you.
So I'll leave it to KG talk, and I'll just add to whatever you say with the example of also as well.
No, I mean, this is an advancement in sort of manipulating genetic material so that you can modify genes and so on. But I think, again, I think the issue goes way beyond CRISPR. you know, CRISPR is a technique, there will be additional techniques and so on. I think that the difficulty for being human is that we are really wedded to the idea of technology. We're good at technology, we're good at inventing things, and we apply these in a lot of different ways. And the problem is that we apply them in both ways. You know, it doesn't matter whether we're talking about atomic energy, it doesn't matter whether we're talking about computers, and now we're on the verge of the greatest technical revolution of all, artificial intelligence moving to a level which we are just beginning to grasp, you know. And so I think that the issue, the reality is that every technology which comes along is going to be used for purposes which are beneficial, and I am sure there are going to be unwanted consequences, and I am also sure that there are going to be people who use them in ways which are really questionable, and I think that's unavoidable.
In terms of the polio virus, even using technology that was available 2 decades ago, there is a very eminent polio virus called Eckhard Wimmer, who was based at the State University of New York in Stony Brook, the one in Long Island. And in 2001, he and his team, using material that you could basically mail order, right? Electric primers, chemicals, I'm not quite sure what they did, it recreated viable poliovirus particles. And the point that he was making is that polio is relatively easy because it's an extremely strong, small virus. But if you can do it for the poliovirus, you can basically recreate with a little harder and with adequate, and you need to be technically adept, but it is possible to recreate every pathogen, whether it's been eradicated or not. So this technology has always been there. We already have the technology to destroy the human race a million times over with the, you know, with the atomic bomb, and that's about three, I don't know how many decades old now. So this is the whole point. We have, there are a lot of things we can, terrible things that we can do to each other with the our existing technology. But at the same time, and this is what is really heartening about the human race, the fact that we've survived this long is probably due to this, we are using those same technologies for good, right? So these same gene editing technologies we are using for a variety of things, down to, you know, treating infants, detecting, diseases or genetic conditions in children before they're even born. We use nuclear energy for power, whether you agree with it or not, that is a peaceful use of nuclear energy. So I think this really is the issue. You know, we have all these technologies. The question really is, at the end of the day, is how do we prevent them from? We tend to use them for good rather than for bad. And I still, maybe I'm an optimist at heart, but I believe if you look at the record of what has happened over, you know, all these centuries, at the end of the day, we have used whatever science and technology we have done for good. No, that's my belief anyway.
Question or a comment or a thought?
Yes. I'd like to push you a little bit more about the eradicationist impulse and where it's coming from. As a historian, I want to historicize it, to say that perhaps you were looking at the connections between wars on Taliban and polio. Do you think that the Second World War and the idea of a sort of total campaign has something to do with this moment in time when eradication comes on the agenda? Or are we talking about some sort of trans-historical impulse that veers towards big projects? Is there a moment in the mid-20th century?
I have some thoughts on this. To go back, it's way before the Second World War, so I think this is something far deeper, because the first eradication campaign, probably a misnomer, was the attempt to stamp out yellow fever from Cuba during the immediately after the Spanish-American War and the U.S. occupation of Cuba, and the then U.S. Secretary of State, speaking to Congress or making a public statement of some sort, said that, you know, one of the reasons why Cuba is important to the United States is that it is the main source of yellow fever coming into Florida, whatever that coast is, I guess the southeastern coast. And he said this is a national imperative. And so, but they were also medical people who felt that this was possible. It wasn't in the end. And the reason was, so the early attempts to eradicate yellow fever was trying to eradicate the vector, the Aedes mosquito. And so there was this huge move to kill every Aedes mosquito in Cuba, later in the Panama Canal, and so on and so forth. So this is an impulse
that's on a global, concerted global effort.
It was
elimination. You can understand that it's a consortium behind this global impulse. It seems to be slightly different in the 20th century.
I think that would have grown global. I mean, if there had been other sources of yellow fever, maybe say from the Philippines, which was affecting the United, it would have become global, right? And the same thing with malaria, you saw that as well. So I think it's an older thing.
Robert, I think a couple different thoughts here. I think that there's the rhetoric of eradication, which I think that, actually in Thomas's book, there's, I think, how it ties into the rhetoric from the past related to wars and so on, I think is real. I think there is a kind of, but I think that behind that, there's something a little bit different. I think there's the rhetoric. I think that a lot of big things, you know, when I first started talking about big things, these are audacious ideas, going to the moon, eradicating smallpox. They're somehow very satisfying issues or ideas which are really driven by people who have big ideas, big egos, and so on. And often you present things in that way because it's the only way to get them funded, really. You know, it's very hard to get something like, well, we'll just make things a little bit better, or we'll do things a little bit better, or you fund that, and so on. It's not really a satisfying way for people to spend money. I'll be very blunt, for the people giving the money. But I think to come to your question at the global level, why do things come together like that, and does it reflect, you know, decision-making at the global level, and this is within countries, among countries, within countries and among countries, when they get together, it's not so different than how people would make a decision in this room or so on, in that oftentimes that if you are in the World Health Assembly or another grouping, a dominant idea by a dominant person becomes very hard to say, I don't like that idea or I disagree with it. It really takes something to say that. In the history of polio, Thomas's book really captures how someone like the Director General Mahler went from one position to another, a very influential change in position. It would be very hard for people to say, you know, Director General Mahler, we don't think this is the direction we should go in, and so on. So, it's an indirect way to answer your question, but I think all of these things really conspire. The final point is that among the people that I know who are scientists who really believe in eradication, public health people, you know, who are completely solid and they have nothing about World War II coursing through them or those sort of things, they fundamentally believe that, you know, this is possible to do and we ought to do it. It is that argument, if you can do it and you have the capacity, then you are morally compelled to do it. And I do know people like that, and I have no doubt that that is completely how they see it. So I see at different levels and different ways these decisions being made.
Yes, I'm gonna take her next because we've had three male panelists and two male questioners. Chromosome mix.
I'm really struck by, in the conversation that you were talking initially, so much about this thing of equity and the notion of sort of equity between countries and how this has changed over the last 50 years, because I think the thing that's sort of interesting, that also I'm sort of questioning now, is, okay, why did smallpox succeed? I mean, the urge to eradicate polio came, what, roughly 20 years, 25 years after smallpox was successfully eradicated. And so what is it that you think fundamentally is the difference in those 25 years? Societal, health systems, actually equity for people, the end of colonialism in much of the developing world. Why did smallpox succeed? I guess, you know, given everything that you've said about polio.
I mean, technically, there's a difference between smallpox and polio. It was easier in the sense of the way the disease transmits and so on. I'll leave KG to, be much better at explaining that than I am. But I will leave you with something that one of the leaders of the smallpox program, a person called D.H. Henderson, who you probably met, and he said, he was asked this, and he said, it was just by the grace of God. I mean, this is not a satisfactory answer, but he said we were so close to failure again and again and again that we pulled it off. And he was convinced that polio was not going to succeed. And this is something that there was this tension between him and the leaders of the polio program and, you know, saying that why shouldn't we succeed as well? But he felt that was, you know, it was, they were really lucky. And plus, I think there were significant epidemiological reasons why smallpox was easier to control than polio was, and perhaps I think would you like to
that? Can I just follow up? So you don't think it was fundamentally like a socio-political difference in, you know, because the world in the 1960s was quite different than the world in the 1990s and the 2000s, and I'm curious that whether you think it's really epidemiological and related to the nature of the virus, or
I think sociopolitically it was different, but let me take you back to the 1970s. There was a war that led to the creation of Bangladesh, as brutal as anything that we've seen now, and that provided, you know, sort of space for the polio, for smallpox to re-emerge, just carried by refugee populations. Smallpox in the Horn of Africa was extremely challenging because you had civil war going on, you had widely dispersed populations. I don't think it was that much easier in terms of the effort that needed to be put in. And to be honest, I think this is probably a long way of saying I really don't know the answer. Why has polio persisted for so long? Why has it been so much harder than smallpox was? There's an epidemiological reason which public health people will put forward. But they're probably, you're right, there are probably deeper societal reasons. Maybe the nature of war is different now. Maybe government... Smallpox also, the other thing was it was much shorter. The thing with an eradication program is it requires an immense effort, your entire health system, all the resources you have are focused on zapping this one microbe. And you can sustain that if the job gets done maybe in 5-6 years. But over if you miss that window of opportunity and 15 years later, you can no longer afford to keep this, you know, this momentum up. So smallpox was done quickly. Maybe it was luck. Maybe it was something else. I think I'm going to pass this.
This is a question coming from my wife. No, I think that I also don't know the answer, but I suspect a couple of things. One of them, among the technical issues, and you know, as you point out in your book, the performance of polio vaccine varies from location to location. So in some places where it works really pretty well, in other places you can vaccinate multiple times and it still doesn't act that effectively. In parts of India, that was a real problem with polio. And I think the performance of the smallpox vaccine was more consistent. But for me, I think that the geopolitical context has changed a lot. I think that, for example, 25 years ago, the nature of communications, social media was not nearly as developed as it is now. And so now we live in an era where we know that social communications can lead to mass movements, can lead to complete changes in opinions about things seemingly overnight. and I suspect that there is a very strong element about that which has made it more difficult. And you know, again, I don't really know if it's true or not. I was not part of either campaign. My sense is that it is more difficult now to get that two-day, three-day period between warring groups and so on. And when I've talked with some of my colleagues who do work on polio about how many negotiations it takes to simply make a little bit of space to get vaccination done, I get the sense that it has just become much more dangerous and more difficult, even though it's always been dangerous for people wandering between warring groups.
Thank you for that. Back to another male.
Well, thank you. Right. I'm another historian of medicine, right, and I'm also interested in the term eradication, but not in a rhetoric way. Right. We historians always also ask that why didn't we learn things from the past? And look, now we have a whole this range of different different eradication programs. Only smallpox was successful. And then so, and instead, if we look at like the malaria eradication program, the largest scale in size, the most extravagant program of WHO, and in 1968, it quietly shifted its direction from eradication to control. And for the story of polio, at the beginning, what instigated that kind of optimism for public health brothers, right? And then we know that money is an issue. When you talk about polio, I always saw the rotaries and talk about the role of rotaries.
I think had smallpox not been eradicated, there would have been polio, there would have been no. So number one, the success of the smallpox program. And there were a number of public health experts, prominent figures in the world of public health say, you know, we've done this one, let's zap the next one. And we can do this. We have proved with smallpox that it is possible to eradicate the disease. So I think there was that, and there was a great push among a certain section of public health experts, really influential people, largely in the United States, saying that now is the time to, you know, go for smallpox. As against that, the WHO itself was extremely reluctant. Mahler, extremely influential, charismatic, probably one of the greatest leaders that the WHO has had, was completely against single disease eradication programs. He said, this is not what public health should be about. And he launched this huge this campaign for primary health care under a new banner, Health for All by the year 2000, and so on and so forth. So the WHO at that point was, and it's a long story how Mahler sort of changed his mind. Rotary, I think, was extremely influential. And why did Rotary get into this? Rotary wanted to do something really big for its 100th anniversary. And they had already done small programs in the Philippines of distributing polio vaccine. It was successful. The vaccine actually, it's almost miraculous. When it works well, it's almost miraculous. Polio disappeared from the The oral polio vaccine was also ideally suited for non-medical people, people like Rotarians, to get involved because anyone could do this. So it was great for a service organization, a polio program, let's do something big for our 100th anniversary. And health, there were a number of prominent figures from the world of public health who were Rotarians as well. And included, and Albert Sabin also, he was urging, he was you know, sort of encouraging Rotary to go this way. So they said, let's go for polio. The WHO at first would not give them the time of day. And they were rebuffed fairly cruelly, I think, by Mahler. Mahler changed his mind. One of the last things he did 2 weeks before he retired from WHO was saying, let's go for polio eradication. So immediately after Mahler left, the first question the WHO did was write to Rotary International saying, will you give us a couple of million dollars to fund positions for this? And Rotary said yes, because they had the money. And that was really how, without Rotary, it's hard to say, maybe there would have been some other organization. But without somebody providing the money, this would never have taken off. And I think that was a really important factor in this.
Fantastic.
Yes.
Just here.
So, in terms of the major public health problems we are facing today, now, as we all know, we are still struggling from problems like child mortality, HIV, contaminated waters, etc., etc. But as Keiji just mentioned, that he thinks climate change is definitely one of the top concerns. So my question is, why do you think this way, and how specifically does climate change influence public health?
So the way I kind of look at these sorts of issues is that there are core issues which have expanded over time. If we look at public health from its inception, disease has always been at the heart of public health at the beginning. So really attention to infectious diseases. And now we're very concerned about non-communicable diseases, you know, obesity, heart disease, and so on. But also during this expansion of time, we have become, we've really highlighted our concerns about things like poverty, the ethics of what we are doing, determinants of health, and so on. So there has been an expansion of these kinds of issues over time. But if I stand back and I look and I think, what are the issues that we are really going to struggle with? Actually, at the top of my personal list, this is not what you're going to read in the textbook, but at the top of my personal list is actually the unanticipated consequences of artificial intelligence. I think the social implications and all of these things we have not begun to think about these things, and I think that the consequences of rapid development of new technology, which will displace really large parts of society. We're simply not paying attention to it. And so it's one of those issues which is clear. We are going to one day say, wow, we're really caught by surprise. Why is this happening? Why didn't we deal with this earlier? But the second thing is that if we look at an issue like climate change, you know, I often think about issues that if we do everything right, can we deal with the issue? And so with climate change, if we were to do everything right now and sort of reverse the increase in carbon dioxide in the atmosphere and so on, the consequences of the heating up process is already here. It will take a long time to really reverse those. And when I look at the reality, will we come to actually be able to get countries to agree to take steps needed to deal with the issue? It's not going to happen overnight. You know, no matter what the rhetoric is, again, it's just not going to happen overnight. And so for me, the scale of that kind of physical change to the Earth and the consequences in terms of people, species, and all of these things is really unimaginable. And so these are the two issues, actually, which are on top of my own personal list. It doesn't mean that anything else has been diminished. I mean, we're still going to have to deal with infectious diseases, with antimicrobial resistance, and with obesity, and all of these things. They haven't gone away. It's just that we are now having issues to deal with which are so complex in terms of the politics and getting people to agree. Hard enough to get polio, you know, how are we going to really get industries and richer countries and poor countries to really deal with these super issues like climate change and artificial intelligence? And I think that we don't know how to do that.
I told them that one there first, back to you here.
We've missed some of the deadlines for polio eradication by now. I was wondering, how important do you think are societal and political issues when it comes to disease eradication?
Sorry, what do I think of the political issues?
Political and societal issues are that are there for, you know, because the reason that we've not been able to eradicate polio by now. Do you think it could be because of those political and societal issues? Or because we have invested a lot of resources and fundings into it?
Largely, it's a mixture, I think, of three issues. One is from the scientific and technical, the vaccine did not work as well in certain high disease settings like India as it did in other areas. And then, yes, I think it was political and societal issues. Geopolitical issues in the sense that this got trapped within, the post 9/11 world. Societal issues in terms of how do we get communities that have been always existed at the fringes of society, minorities of various kinds, and here it is very different actually from HIV/AIDS, which I think also happened in a wealthy country. So even the minority voices there were not disenfranchised. They were educated. They were articulate enough to voice their concerns. But in poorer countries, it doesn't quite work that way. And you're disenfranchised. Those who live at the fringes of society are desperately poor. They are malnourished. They really look down upon by everybody. And they're very suspicious of everybody as well. And so I think it was this mixture, basically, it was all of these things, I think, which have, why polio has taken so much longer than anticipated to disappear.
And if you want a more comprehensive answer to that question, there's a great book actually table by there. We have one more question over here, and then we'll probably have one or two more after that.
Hi, my name is Grace. I'm a medical student, and I apologize in advance for being a little detail-oriented. So my question is to actually just want to clarify the story that you told us about the father who exploded in anger about why polio?
Yeah.
So is it because, well, I've asked you a couple of like smaller questions. So my first question is, was it because he couldn't see the paralytic effects of polio around him because it was pretty much eradicated? But then also at the same time, there was a mother who was more than willing to bring her child to be vaccinated with other vaccines. So that got me thinking, I'm assuming those other vaccines covering measles or whooping cough, for example, were also not prevalent in the community because it was so well vaccinated. And if that's the case, why was the target on polio and not other diseases? But then if we talk about the other side of the reason for rejection due to the conspiracies, right, the sterilization and all that, then it got me thinking that why weren't those conspiracy theories applied to other vaccines? So, for example, at the beginning, it was actually the hepatitis vaccine in Pakistan that was almost hijacked, right? And so I was thinking then, again, why did polio become a target? And the reason why I'm asking all these was because I was involved with some public health interventions in rural China on really simple things like hand hygiene. So, important moments where you wash your hands, one including after you use the bathroom. But then we realized it turns out because a lot of ladies actually don't use toilet paper when they use the bathroom, and so there is never a moment where they actually use their hands. And so that's why it's so hard to tell them to wash their hands afterwards, because there simply wasn't a need for it. So the reason why I was clarifying all this is because I really want to understand the psychology behind it, and sometimes understand like these are the small, trivial things that trip up an entire project. And then on my second larger question, which is kind of off tangent, since we're on the note of vaccines, I'm wondering what will be Professor Abraham's view on a journalistic view on the anti-vaccine movement from the West, which is now spreading to Hong Kong.
Thank you very much for those questions. I'll try and answer them as best I can. Going back to Nigeria, what were the reasons for rejection? Partly, I think you've already polio, and I think you've hit on one thing, which also answers your second question. Polio really was a rare disease. In the larger disease ecology of Nigeria and most parts of the, it was a rare disease. As is increasingly diseases like measles and so on in the Western world. And so it's really easy to be anti-vaccine, and this is where I'm going to your second question now, when you don't see the disease at all. And then you say this must be a conspiracy, and why would anyone bother about measles, right? Or if you're slightly older, you would say, we had measles as kids and nothing happened, right? So why are they pushing these vaccines on us? And mainly because the disease has almost disappeared. Polio was a disease also that was very, very, it was really visible. I mean, you may have had a couple of hundred cases, 200 cases in a country the size of Nigeria, which is a drop in the larger disease environment of the country. So this made it easier, I think, for questioning and suspicion. And here's where communication comes in. Whether it was in Nigeria, whether it was in Pakistan, when people said, why polio, polio? Nobody explained to people saying that we're trying to eradicate this across the world and this is the last place in the world where polio exists. And you guys get rid of it, we are protecting every child in the world from now to kingdom come from polio. Anybody would have bought into that. But our health communication is also very bureaucratic. And so you have slides, because everybody is assumed to be stupid and illiterate. You have these picture slides showing a child with polio, and you have a picture of somebody putting the drop in, and how the child doesn't get polio after that, and you've got these women explaining to other women. But the real issue was never addressed. The real reason makes perfect sense to anybody. Whether you go to Pakistan, whether you go to Nigeria, and you tell somebody, we want to get rid of this because this is one of the last places in the world we have it. And we're protecting not just your children, but every child, you know, till the end of time. People would have bought into it. So I think, I'm not quite sure I've addressed all your questions, but these are some of the thoughts that, you know, that your questions are.
Maybe just to add on to what Thomas said, because I think that in my experience, lack of trust is what undermines almost everything. And in an emergency or an urgent situation, oftentimes there's urgency on one side and not on the other. And it really creates a dynamic which is difficult. You know, it's really hard to go in and say, this is really important, when the other side is saying, what are you talking about? Why is this important? And so on. And I think this is something which happens actually fairly often. It's certainly not a polio unique issue. But the second thing is that the communication, you know, partly it's an issue of trust, partly it's an issue of communication. In West Africa with Ebola, one of the most memorable meetings I ever went to was with a group of people who were representing the group of people in Monrovia, and they were representing basically an area of the city which had been walled off by the government. And the people who were allowed to talk basically said, we know that we are both basically, you know, being excluded, and, you know, we know we have a high chance of dying. They're very articulate, very clear, very well spoken, and so on. And I think the nature of what you said is that, you know, a lot of times, if you don't understand, you know, people are intelligent. You know, they are very astute, and so on. And so our communication is really poor in a lot of ways. And so part of it is that we don't communicate in the right way. We don't do it in a way which really builds understanding. But it is also made harder in a situation which is inherently permeated with distrust. And that distrust often goes, is there from way before. You know, populations, many populations completely distrust their own governments. And they distrust strangers coming in. And, you know, it's all understandable. But you still have to somehow get through that. And sometimes they do.
We've got time for one more. Somebody's got a question right next to you.
Thank you.
Jumped up so quickly.
Thank you, Professor, for sharing. I'm also from the medical faculty. And from what you just mentioned just now about in Pakistan, the parents are being threatened with jail if they don't allow their children to receive the vaccination for polio. I was wondering, so I think that in some ways it is sacrificing like a small of a population's kind of ethical concerns or rights for the greater good of the whole like global health, and it is, I'm assuming that it's very effective. So forgive me for not phrasing this like more eloquently, but in some ways, ethical concerns are preventing our society from achieving like polio eradication or like global health in general. I was wondering what your view on this is, and like maybe there should be a shift in how people like consider factors when they're considering global health issues.
I'm not quite sure. In what way? How are ethical considerations preventing? I don't quite get the thrust of your. It's an interesting question, but I need to understand a little bit more.
Yeah. So what I mean is, for the story that you've just mentioned, people are being threatened with. Going to jail.
Okay, I get it. Yeah.
So you mentioned that it's very uncomfortable for us to hear because they are in a you think they're in the bottom of the pecking order.
Yeah.
And so their
kind
of ethical setting is not.
Yeah. Yeah. And the question is clear now.
Thank you.
I think you can make arguments on both sides. One is that this is a global imperative, let's just do it, right? And if we're not doing anybody any harm, and so let's just not get too finicky about getting consent and so on and so forth, let's just do it. And I can understand that perfectly. For me, from a moral point of view, I get very uncomfortable when people in one part of the world are treated differently from people at the other part of the world. And that personally makes me very, very uncomfortable. And if you have different standards for informed consent, different standards for communication, in the developed West, before a doctor even gives a child its routine immunization, there are a whole bunch of, explanation, discussion that need to happen between the doctor and the patient. And many public health people will be impatient by this, they get impatient with this. And maybe it's excessive, but I do believe we need one global standard. And that you cannot do things in one part of the world just because you think they're far away and they don't have a voice that you would not dare do in another part of the world. But at the same time, I understand why people do this as well. Probably a most unsatisfactory answer, but there you are. Sorry.
I think this goes at to the heart of the dilemma about public health. I mean, how do you practice informed consent, which is in many ways our optimal idea about how should things be done? Explain things to people, they understand it, and then they agree. And you hope they agree that the way that you want them to agree, but at least it is truly informed and it is truly consent. And then there are instances where we say, this is not working. We have somebody who has complete resistance to tuberculosis and they say, forget it, I'm still going out there and I'm doing whatever I want. Or you have somebody who is HIV infected and says, I'll have sex with anybody I want and it's unprotected sex and this is my business and not your business. And so I think that what you're discussing here, what you're asking about, what you're discussing, exists in many forms. Other than to say that every time that comes up, you have to really think it through and talk it through. I'm not sure that there's a better way to that. I often will simply tell people, it may seem repetitive, but every time something like this comes up, we have to talk it through. We have to just go through the pain of figuring out what is the right thing to do and try to do it.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. If you are part of the HKU community here, and I think most of you are, next week is Reading Week. And so if you're looking for something to read, I've got a terrific book back there. And I guarantee you should start that one right away. Just start it this weekend, and you will probably be finished with it by Sunday or so. It's a really easy read.
Keith doesn't get
chapter.
A cut, okay?
I don't get a cut off of it, but it is Reading Week coming up, so it's absolutely the perfect time.
Sorry.
There's a limited number of copies, and I'm told that if you buy it here, you can actually get an autograph from Mr. Thomas Abraham here. He's lost his voice now, so it's a perfect time to say goodbye and thank you. Keiji Fukuda, thank you for doing this. Thomas, thank you. And while you give them a round of applause, I want you all to give yourself a round of applause for breaking in this beautiful new room, seminar room, that you are a terrific audience to have here for this event.